Okay, am I audible? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so I couldn't take class. This is a scheduled class actually. Okay. So, in the last class, just I'm summarizing whatever I have discussed. Just I have given the definition of complex valued function and how we could geometrically interpret a function of complex variable. So, we have discussed that. We could consider that the function of complex variable is transforming a two-dimensional geometrical figure from the independent plane, that means from Z plane to W plane. So up to that I have discussed. Okay, so let me share my screen, and today I will be discussing the limit of a complex valued function. Can you see it? Can you see this blank screen?
Yes, sir.
So, today we'll study the limit of a complex valued function. Okay, so limit of a complex valued function. So I have told that in the last class, any complex valued function can be written in the form fz equals to w, where z is the independent variable and w is the dependent variable. Since z and w both are complex numbers, so z can be considered as x plus iy, where x is the real part of z and y is the imaginary part of z, and w can be written in the form of u plus iv, where u is the real part of w and v is the imaginary part of w. And geometrically, you could interpret that just by independent variable, we are taking some points in the z plane, and each and every point in the z plane that we are considering by virtue of the function f is mapped to some points in the w plane. So by joining those points, that means the independent variables z that we are considering, we are getting a two-dimensional geometrical figure in the z plane. So by joining their corresponding images in the w plane, we will be getting another two-dimensional geometrical figure in the W plane. So you could consider that this function transforms a two-dimensional geometrical figure from Z plane to W plane. So this is the geometrical interpretation and this was the function. So instead of writing down this, we can write down the function in the form of f x comma y equals to u comma v. That means we know that in the argon plane by ordered pair, we actually can denote the complex numbers. In form of x, y, we denote that x is the real part, y is the imaginary part. In form of u, v, we denote that u is the real part and v is the imaginary part. Okay. So, in that way, we could represent a function of complex variable. Then we will be studying the limit of a function. So, in the last class, whenever I have discussed the geometrical significance of function of complex variable, I have discussed the relationship between the geometrical significance of function of one real variable and function of two real variable. Because all of you have studied this earlier. So, if we could discuss by comparing it with the previous knowledges that you have, you will be able to understand this very easily. So, similarly, whenever we will be going to discuss the limit of a complex valued function, before that, we will be just recapitulating the knowledge of limit that you have completed, you have done in function of one real variable and function of two real variable, and we will incorporate those things here to identify or to actually visualize what is the limit for function of complex variable and how you could actually check it. So before that, just I consider the simple thing that I have studied in class 11. The function y equals to fx is a function. So we are taking a limit at the point say x equals to x0. So my question is, why do we take limit for a particular function at a given point? Can anyone just tell me? Because from 11 you have done this in 11. So what is the necessity of taking the limit of a function? If a function of one variable y equals to fx is given to you and you are asked to find out the limit at the point x equals to x0.
Actually, we check the means at the point x naught from left hand side and right hand side slope. If it is equal, then its limit is
not slope. Slope we check by differentiation. By limit we don't check slope. By doing the differentiation by f dash x, we actually denote the slope of the tangent. Is that clear or not?
Yes.
But by limit we don't check it. So, can anyone, any other, can tell me why do we check the limit? This is the important thing, because you have used lots of rules to evaluate the limit. And this is a very important topic in function. You have studied in class 11, 12 and in joint entrance examination and in your board examination, you have calculated several limits. But my question is, why do we take the limit? What is the necessity of taking the limit for a particular function at a given point? That is very much important to know why do we take the limit. After that, we can use different formulas, different rules to evaluate the limit. But before proceeding, we should know what is the necessity of taking the limit. Why do we take the limit? A function is given, a point is given. What is the necessity of taking the limit? Any other? Anyone? Amongst you? Whatever is coming to your mind. This answer can be wrong. This answer can be... may not be valid, but whatever is coming to your mind, what do you think? Anything, whatever is coming to your mind. Can I get my question? Is it clear? The question is clear. Have you understood the question?
Yes, sir.
And then anyone? This is a very important thing. In class 11, you have studied this.
Sir, is it to check the continuity at that point?
No, after finding out the limit, we check the continuity. So, continuity, differentiability, all are different criteria of a function that we check by using the limit. But they are not actually the cause of taking limit for a particular function.
Sir, we check from the different path, that is, if its value is... same from different path, then it's
this is for limited. Function of two variable that you did in first semester, but for function of one real variable. Okay,
sorry.
Just let me explain. Anyone amongst you? So this is a very simple thing you have studied in class 11. So didn't you ask your teacher that what is the necessity of taking limit in a school day whenever the limit has been discussed? Because it's a very important thing. So a function is given, you know the importance of function, why do you use function? But what is the importance of limit? So why you are when you are using different rules to evaluate the limit, then first this question should come to your mind, that what is the importance of taking limit? Whenever you will study anything, so in my class also, if you don't understand why we are doing that, you can ask me. So it may possible that I don't know the answer of each of the questions that you are asking, but there is a reason behind each and everything that we are doing. Okay, just let me explain. So, what is the significance of function? So, function actually correlates the value of one set to another set. So, A and B are two sets and we are defining a function. So, X we are taking as the inputs from the set A and the value of X is lying in the set B in the form of Y. So, Y is equals to fx. That means by virtue of that function or act that we are considering, X is mapped to Y. That means we are providing the relationship between each and every point of X to some points of V. So, that is the significance of function. Okay. So, while we are defining a function, there must have a domain, there must have a codomain. So, from domain we are taking the inputs and the functional values are, there in the codomain. So, that's why domain and codomain are important. So, while we are defining this function, that's why since X is the value, that is the independent variable that we are considering for the domain. So, for each and every value, so this is a definition of function, that function should be defined for each and every value of domain. That means X we can take as any arbitrary value from D and the functional value, that means Y, must exist corresponding to each and every value that we are considering from the domain. That means X can be this value, X can be this value, any value we can consider from the domain, and the value Y, that means corresponding functional value of X, Y must exist for each and every value that we are considering on the domain A. Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir. Okay. Yes, sir.
So, our main importance, main motto here is to find out or define functional value corresponding to each and every value that we are considering the domain. That is our main motto. Now, what happens whenever we define this function? Let's say we are defining a function from R to R. Fx is a very important function and you have used this function several times whenever you have studied limits. So, let's say this is a function. So, here inputs, what we are taking? So, we are taking the input as a real number. That means, for any real value x, the functional value fx must exist. Is that clear or not? Because here, domain we are considering as a set of real number. So, root 2 is a real number, 1.212 is a real number. So, for any real number, the value of fx must exist. That means, we should put the value of x here and for any arbitrary value of x, which is a real number, we should get the value of fx. Is that clear? Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir.
But what happened? What is happening here? So, while we are putting the value of x as 2, we are getting that the functional value doesn't exist. This is in the form of 0 by 0. So, that is infinity. But while we are defining this function, so this is the basic criteria of the function is that the functional value must exist for each and every value that we are considering from the domain. So, here domain being the set of real numbers. So, functional value must exist for each and every real number. But here x equals to 2 is a real number. But from the definition of the function, we are finding that the functional value doesn't exist. So, there is a problem because while we are defining this function, we should have a functional value corresponding to each and every real number. But this is not happening for x equals to 2. So, then how to resolve that problem? Because in order to define the function, we need to get a value corresponding to x equals to 2. Otherwise, this will not be a function. Otherwise, this will be a function from the set of real number minus 2. If I eliminate or exclude 2 from the set of real numbers, then it will be a function. Because 2 is not now included in the domain. This is our domain now. So, 2 is not included. So, the function is now defined for each and every value from this domain. But while we are considering the domain as set of real numbers, so this is not a function until we are providing a particular value corresponding to the value x equals to 2. Is that clear? Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir.
So, the main motto of finding out the limit is that while we are defining a function in a particular domain, so the functional value must exist for each and every value which we are considering from that domain. But if it doesn't happen, that means if we are not getting a functional value corresponding to a particular value that we are considering the domain, we actually often check limit or often try to find out the limit. Limit means the limiting value, that means the approximated value. So, here we can't provide the functional value corresponding to x equals to 2. That means we can't provide the exact functional value because if I put here x equals to 0, the value will be 2. If I put x equals to 1, the value will be minus 4. The value will be 4. So, we know that value will be 3. So, here if I put any value of x, I will be getting the exact value of fx. But for x equals to 2, I am not getting the exact value. So, for those points, in the domain where we are not getting the exact value of the function, by putting the value of that independent variable in the function, that definition of the function, then we need to take the limit to check whether we could approximately find out the functional value at that given point or not. So if we could find out approximated value of the function at the given point where the function is not defined directly, then we say that limit exists. Limit means the approximated value we can't provide for this function at this particular value. But if it is not possible for us to provide approximated value corresponding to a particular point which we are considering from the domain, then we say that the limit doesn't exist. So when the limit exists, so if a function is not defined at a particular point, let's say a function y equals to fx is not defined at a particular point x equals to x0, then we take limit. So there are two possibilities. It may exist, it may not exist. So if it exists, then we could approximate the functional value fx at the point x equals to x0. And if it doesn't exist, then we can't approximate the functional value fx at the point x equals to x0. Then it will not be a function. Then we need to exclude x0 from the domain. Otherwise, it will not be a function. But if I can approximate the functional value, limiting value means approximated value. If I can provide approximated value for that function at this given point, then we say that limit exists. Is that clear?
Yes, sir. Understood.
Yes, sir.
Is that clear for all? Because this is the main thing we need to know behind the limit. That is the main reason that we take the limit for a function at a given point. Okay. Now the process. What is the process? So here, let's say this is a function of one variable. So the independent variable will be one axis and the dependent variable will be another axis. So we need to take two-dimensional real plane. So let's say at x equals to 2, the function is not defined. Okay. So here, at x equals to 2, the function is not defined. So here, the number of independent variable is 1. So we can actually represent the independent variable in the form of x-axis. So in x-axis, since the number of independent variable is only 1, so we could identify the independent variable in only one axis. So if I consider a straight line, and if I want to move from a point along this straight line, what are the possible directions? Have you got my point? Say a straight line is given, from one point we want to move along the straight line. So what are the number of directions we could consider to move along the straight line from a given point over the straight line? Have you got my question or not?
So repeat once.
So here number of independent variable is 1. So since the number of independent variable is 1, so we can represent the independent variable in one straight line, one axis, one real axis. Now, if a straight line is given to you and one point is fixed, then from this point we want to move along this straight line. Then what are the possible directions?
Sir, two directions.
Yeah, sure. There are two directions, because from this point, if I want to move along this straight line, either we can move towards this or we can move towards this. So since here the number of independent variable is 1, so there are two possible directions that we could move from any other point to that point which we are considering as an independent variable. So let's say this is a function. So roughly, this is not the exact graph of the function, but I am drawing the approximated graph of the function. So this is the graph fx. So at x equals to 2, there is no functional value. Apart from x equals to 2, at all other points, this is the functional value. At this point, this is the functional value. So at, for any point, any value x, we can draw a perpendicular and this length will be the functional value. But at the point x equals to 2, there is no functional value. So we want to check whether we can approximate the functional value at the point x equals to 2 or not. For that, we are taking, since there are two possible directions that we could change the value from x equals to 2 in a straight line. So we are taking a left hand side, we are taking a right hand point around x equals to 2, and they are very close values. They are very close to 2 actually. That means we are taking an interval, because if a straight line is given in a straight line around a point, we can take the neighborhood as an interval. This can be a closed interval, this can be open interval. So we are taking here an open interval. So around x equals to 2, we are taking open interval. So let's say this length is So this length in the right hand side of 2 and left hand side of 2 which we are considering must be same. So right hand side of 2 we are taking a length say 0.0001. So this point will be up to 2.0001. The left hand side this will be 2 minus this. So 2 minus this means 1.9999. So this point. So we are taking a small value. Then if I consider this function x square minus 4 by x minus 2. Just we want to verify apart from x equals to 2 at all other points the function is defined because only the point x equals to 2 is there where this function is not defined. So we will be putting all other values in the right hand side of 2, that means 2.00001, 2.0000, that means we are taking different points which are there in the right hand side of 2 in that interval. Then if you put the values here you will be getting a functional value and functional value will be very close to 4 but slightly greater than 4, that means 4.00001, 4.00001, like that. That means they are very close to 4 but greater than 4. That means this is a functional value in the y direction. So let's say this is 4, this is 4 and this is greater than 4. And if you take the value of x in the left hand side of 2 which is very close to 2 and are there in that interval, in that portion, that means 1.999, 1.99998, like that. And if you put it here, you will be getting that the functional value exists. And they are very close to 4, but slightly less than 4. That means in the bottom of this value 4. So this is the value 4. So if you put the function, if you take the value of x is greater than 2, then you will be getting functional value in that direction. And if you put the left hand values of 2, you will be getting slightly less than 4 but closer to 4. So that's why, while we are varying the independent variable around 2 in a small interval, we are getting that the functional value will also lie in a small interval around 4. So that's why, here we can say that the limiting value or approximated value of this function at x equals to 2 can be considered at 4. So graphically, first we have verified that and we have successfully checked that 4 can be the approximated value because while we are going towards right hand side of 2, the value is going towards right hand side of 4, that means towards greater than 4. And whenever we are moving from 2 to left hand side, that means whenever we are taking the lesser value compared to 2, we are getting the functional value is very much closer to 4 but less than 4. So here approximately we can assume the approximated value of the function as 4. After that, we have used different rules. We have used the formula of limit, say x tends to 2. Since x tends to 2, so x is not equals to 2. So that's why here we can factorize this x plus 2 into x minus 2 by x plus 2 into x minus 2. So since x is nearer to 2 but not equals to 2, so this can be deducted. So then the functional value is becoming x equals to x plus 2. So now we can put the value x equals to 2 because this is defined at x equals to 2. So then the functional value becomes 4. So this is the rule. But before that rule, we have actually checked in that way. If you check your 11 class mathematics book, you will be finding that in that way they have actually calculated that. That they are checking the values of x, they are checking the values of y, and they are coming very closer to 4. That's why they are approximating the functional values as 4. If you check the NCERT book, if you check the ML Agarwal book, any book you can check, whatever you have studied, you will be finding that in that way they have calculated first. After that, they have used the formula to evaluate the limit. So this is actually the graphical representation, and by that we can check that limit exists. After that, we use the formulas to evaluate the limiting value. Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir.
Is it clear to all?
Yes, sir.
Now, if I consider this function as 1 by x, let's say. So here also we are defining the function from set of real numbers to set of real numbers. So here what is the domain? Domain is R. So for this function, so like the previous case, here also the function should be defined for each and every value.
Except 0.
That we can consider from R. But here 0 is also included. So since 0 is also included, so at 0 the functional value must exist. But here we are getting that at 0 the value is infinity. So either we should provide the limiting value at 0, then the function can be defined from R. And if I can provide the limiting value or approximated value of this function at 0, then the function must be defined from R minus 0. because if the function is defined at a particular domain, then the functional value must exist for each and every value that we can consider from this domain. So here we need to check graphically first. Okay, so here we'll see what happens. So if I consider the graph of 1 by x, so that means y equals to 1 by x, that means xy equals to 1. So can anyone tell me what is the geometrical representation of this locus of this function? If I consider the function as this, so ultimately this equation is this. So what will be the locus of this equation?
The rectangular hyperbola.
Rectangular hyperbola, that means this will be this kind of things. This is the functional value. Now at 0 the function is not defined. So similarly here also, like the previous case, we need to take a, since there is only one independent variable, so this will be situated in the x-axis. So around x-axis we can take an open interval. So this is our open interval. So in the right hand side, the values will be very close to 0 but greater than 0. That means the positive value 0.999, 0.00001, 0.00000001, like that. In the left hand side, the values will be very closer to 0 but the negative numbers, because left hand side 0, there will be the negative number, that means minus 0.00001, minus 0.00001, like that. Is that clear? So in the, from the right hand side of x equals to 0, whenever you will be coming towards 0, you will be getting that the functional value is going towards plus infinity. Because if you put 0.001, this will be 1 by 1000, this will be 1 by 0.001, that means 1000. If you put this, this will be 10 to the power 5, this will be 10 to the power 6. So more you will be coming closer towards 0 from the right hand side of 0 for this particular function, the functional value is gradually moving up to infinity, plus infinity. And from the left hand side of 0, more you will be moving towards 0, you will be getting that the functional value is going towards minus infinity. Is that clear or not? Is that clear? Or do you have any doubt? If you have any doubt, you could ask me.
No, sir, clear.
Okay. So here, we are varying the independent variable in a very small interval, around 0. We are taking a small interval. But the functional value lies in a huge interval, from plus infinity to minus infinity. So is it possible here to approximate the functional value at a particular value? So here it is not possible, because in the previous case, while we are varying the value of the independent variable around 2, we are getting that the functional value is very close to 4, but it is actually getting changed around 4. But here we are finding that the independent variable we are varying around 0, but the value of the dependent variable is changing from minus infinity to plus infinity, that means in a very huge interval. Okay, so here we can say that the limiting value at x equals to 0 doesn't exist, because we can't provide approximate value of the function at x equals to 0. Is that clear? Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir.
So here, if I define this function from domain R to R, this is not a proper function, because this will not be a function. So I need to rectify the domain and I should define the function from R minus 0 to R, and then it will be our required function fx equals to 1 by x. So domain here must be rectified as 0, at 0 the functional value doesn't exist. Okay, is that clear? Is that clear or not? Have you got it?
Yes, sir.
Then there comes epsilon delta definition. I don't know whether you have studied this in your school days or in the first semester or not. So what is the epsilon delta definition? So arbitrarily, if I consider the function as fx, so let's say this is the function fx at this point x equals to x0, the functional value doesn't exist. This is y equals to fx. So around x equals to x0, we are taking an interval of length delta. So this will be x0 plus delta and this will be x0 minus delta. So this length is delta length. So for this delta length, if this functional value, this say limiting value is L, if the value of function varying from L minus epsilon to L plus epsilon, that means this length is f still m. Okay, so we are varying the independent variable around x equals to x0 in a length of delta. This is very small, and the functional value if lies around L in a small interval, that is epsilon, then we say that the limiting value exists, and then we define limit x tends to x0 fx equals to L. That means x minus x0 less than delta, that implies fx minus L less than epsilon, and this delta and epsilon can be compared. That means here, if I consider the length of delta is 0.001, I'll be getting that the length of epsilon is 0.001 or like that. That means they are comparable. If it is small, delta is small, epsilon is also small. But here we are finding that delta is small, but epsilon is very huge. Epsilon is infinity. So in that case, the limit doesn't exist. That means epsilon and delta must be comparable. That means the value of independent variable, the interval we are varying. Similarly, the functional value must be varied in the same kind of interval. That means the length of the interval must be comparable. Must be, if it is small, then this should be also small. Then the limit exists. Is that clear? Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir.
Now, in the first semester, you have studied how to check the limit for function of two real variable, z equals to fxy. So here the number of independent variables are 2, not 1, they are 2 independent variables, and there is only 1 dependent variable. So here, let's say we need to check the limiting value of the function at the point, let's say x0, y0. Because here the number of independent variables are 2, so we need to check whether this limit exists or not. So here, what is the number of independent variables? This is x, y, and this is z. This point is x0, y0. So that means this is the surface. So at this point x0, y0, the function is not defined. So similarly here also, in the case of function of one variable, the independent variable actually is 1. So that is that exists actually in the x-axis. So, since the number of independent variable is 1, so we can vary the value of independent variable around this point in a small interval. But here, the number of independent variable are 2. So, since the number of independent variable are 2, so it will be there in a two-dimensional plane. That means, xy plane here the independent variable, not one axis. So, if I want to take one neighborhood around this point, so I can take either a circular neighborhood or I can take a rectangular neighborhood. So, this kind of neighborhood I can take because I can't take an interval. Because if I take an interval, either I need to take interval in that direction, either I need to take interval in that direction. So I can't take here interval. Rather, I need to take one two-dimensional closed region around this point in order to identify the neighborhood or the nearer points. So either I can take a circular neighborhood, I can take a rectangular neighborhood, I can take a square neighborhood, but closed neighborhood should be taken. Now, let's say I have taken this circular neighborhood around this point. I want to vary the value of nearer points, I want to check what is the functional value. Then from that, I want to approximate the functional value at the point x0, y0. So here you know that in one dimension, there are two directions actually. Either we can approach from this direction, we can approach from this direction. But if I want to approach from this point, that is a nearer point, to this point, is there any fixed direction that we could approach from this point to this point? Is there any fixed direction? So you want to approach from this point to this point in two dimensions, let's say. Then what are the number of directions we can approach from this point to this point? Can anyone tell me? Have you got my question or not?
So, can you repeat the question?
So, here I want to vary the value of independent variable around this point. So, since the number of independent variable is 1 and it exists in a one-dimensional line, so you have told that I can approach either from this direction, or I can approach from this direction to this point. That means in that interval, if I take any point, then there are only two directions that I could approach to this point. Now here, I need to take a neighborhood as a closed two-dimensional region. That means either by a circle or by a rectangle or by a square. So let's say I want to move from this point to this point. This is a nearer point. So is there any unique directions that I could approach from this point to this point?
No, sir.
So how many directions are there?
Infinite.
So there are infinite directions, because I can approach from this point to this point. There is no fixed line. So I can approach either by straight line, I can approach by this 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 line. So there are infinite number of paths that we could move from this point to this point. So that's why in the previous case, since there are two directions, so if I find the limit from left hand side, if I find the limit from right hand side, and if they are equal, we say that limit exists. But here there are infinite number of directions through which you could approach from one point that is very much nearer to the point where we are going to find the limit to that point. Similarly, if I want to move from this point to this point, there are infinite number of directions. So if I want to check the limit like the previous case, we need to check whether the limiting values are coming same corresponding to these infinite directions. Okay. But that is not possible, because infinite number of directions, we can't check whether the limiting value is coming same if I consider the infinite number of directions from to approach from one point to another point. That is very much impossible. So that's why there are two methods. One is the epsilon delta method, another is the path dependent independent method. So we'll be studying the path dependent independent method, because the problems which will be given to you here, basically you need to check whether limit, you need to check the non-existence of limit. That means you need to check whether limit doesn't exist or not. That means you don't need to check the existence of limit, rather here you need to check the non-existence of limit. So what do we need to do to check the non-existence of limit? So let's say in a circle, from this point we need to approach from this point to this point. So there are infinite number of directions. So to check the existence of the limit, we need to show that limiting values are coming same if we approach from this point to this point in infinite number of ways. But this is impossible. But if we want to show that the limit doesn't exist, what do we need to do? To disprove this, just we need to check any two path, and if I can show that the limiting values are coming different, if I consider two different paths from to approach from this point to this point, let's say I am approaching from this point to this point by this straight line, the limiting value is coming as one particular value, and if I consider this path, the limiting value is coming as different value. So then we can certainly say that the limit doesn't exist, because if limit exists, then the limiting value should be independent of path. That means if I take any arbitrary path, the limiting value should be same. But to disprove that, just we need to show that the limiting values is coming different if I consider any two arbitrary path. Then we are done. Is that clear? Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir.
So that's why you did this in first semester. So just I'm giving one example. Let's say we need to take the limit xy tends to 0, 0, 2xy by x square plus y square. We need to check the existence of this limit at 0, 0. So this is the point 0, 0. So if I want to approach to this point from the nearer points, and you take a circular region, that let's say I'm taking the circular region, then so this is a nearer point. So from this point I can approach by this straight line, I can approach by this straight line, I can approach by this line. So to this point I can approach through different paths. So I can take y equals to mx as a collection of paths. So instead of taking two different arbitrary paths, we are actually taking the family of paths. By y equals to mx, we actually can represent the infinite number of straight lines which passes through origin. So by this path we can approach to the point 0, 0 from nearer points. So if I put here y equals to mx, so there are two variables, y and x. So while we are putting the value of y as mx, so y will be dependent on x. That means the total function will be converted to only one variable. So let's say we are putting the value of y in terms of x. So this will be x tends to 0, 2x, this is mx, this is x square plus m square x square. So if I take x square common, so this will be limit x tends to 0, 2x square m, if I take x square common, 1 plus m. So since x tends to 0, so x is not equal to 0, so this can be deducted. So this limiting value will be 2m by 1 plus m. So here the limiting value is dependent on m. So since the limiting value is dependent on m, so if I take different paths, say let's say we have taken the value of m as 1. So this limiting value will be 2 by 2, so that will be 1. If I take m equals to half, this limiting value will be 1 plus 1 by 1 by 4. So these two are different. So while we are taking the path as y equals to x, I am getting this limiting value. While we are taking the path as y equals to half x, I am getting this limiting value. That means if I take different paths to approach to the point, then I am getting different limiting value. That's why here at once we can say that the limit doesn't exist. So is that clear?
Yes, sir. So you have taught this in first sem.
Yeah, you were taught actually in this first sem. So why I'm why I have discussed this? Because while we'll check the limit for a function of complex variable, we'll adopt this method. Because in the case of function of complex variable, number of independent variable are 2. Fxy equals to u comma v. So since the number of independent variable are 2, so here also independent variable we could consider as a two-dimensional point in the Argon plane. So that's why here also in the same way I could check the existence of limit for a function of complex variable. So here you don't need to study any new method, rather the previous method that you have studied in the first sem, by that we can actually check the existence of limit for a function of complex variable. Is that clear? Is that clear or not?
Yes, sir.
So we'll discuss this in the next class, how to check the limit, and we'll solve different examples. So before I provide you the IMCRB test code, just let me take the attendance manually first, then I'll be signing the test. Rule number 1, 2,
present sir,
3,
present sir,
4, 5,
present sir,
6,
present sir,
3, are you present, 3, rule number 3,
oh. Yes sir, present sir,
present.
Okay, 3 present, 4 absent, no? 4, okay. 5, 6,
present, sir.
7, rule number 7, 8,
present sir,
9, 10,
yes sir,
9, okay, 9 present,
yes sir, present,
10, 11, 11,
present, sir.
Okay, 12,
present,
present sir,
13,
present sir,
14,
present sir,
15,
yes sir,
okay, 16,
hello sir,
17, 18,
present sir,
19,
present sir,
19, So this is the exam code and this is the link. So just click the link and provide your full enrollment number and the exam code and give the test. So just someone amongst you, just check and let me know whether you can access it right now or not.
So it's working.
Okay. So thank you. So just complete this test. So there are two problems. So based on the previous day's class and today's class. So thank you all. I am leaving. So just go through today's class and the topics of today's class, and just let me know whether you have any doubt in the next class. Then I'll be discussing some examples of function of how to check the limit for function of complex variable. Okay. Thank you all for attending the class. I am leaving.